Now listen, you don't need to have my size to serve God. Serve God faithfully in what He has entrusted you to. If you are a cleaner, don't feel like you are less. You will be rewarded not for what you do, but by doing it faithfully. God does not reward work. He rewards faithfulness. Now listen, the reason why God does not reward work is because I can force you to work. And Lord, we affirm the great things you've done in our lives. And we settle on that assurance that you've done great things. And our hearts can testify to it. We receive grace today as we listen to your word in Jesus' name. Amen. Again, like we introduced yesterday, we're talking about being vulnerable, the vulnerability of a believer to the leadings of God. Last week we talked about the simplicity of obedience. We talked about the vulnerability of a believer allowing the leading of the Spirit of God. I want to derive this understanding from the scriptures where the Bible says, "My sheep knows my voice, and they do not follow a stranger." From the principle of the scriptures, you need to understand that the shepherd would not drive the sheep. He rather led the sheep. There must be a vulnerability like that of sheep. In our human language, sheep, or if somebody was to describe something or someone from the position of sheep, it will be a description of foolishness, carelessness, lack of sensitivity, ignorance. But in the scriptures, sheep is defined from a position of innocence. The intention of God was that we be vulnerable to His leading. For this reason, the Holy Spirit is our leader. He leads. You ought to comply by following. He does not force. He does not coerce. He does not create drama. He's a gentleman. He leads. And because of that, you need to understand that the things of God must be expressed in a language that the Bible put it as it were in the mind of God. Vulnerability is an expression of our total trust to a level where in human terms can be described as foolishness. It's a state where you seem to have suspended your thoughts, suspended your knowing, suspended everything that makes reason and make means of life relevant, and begin to align yourself to something alone. Vulnerability. Vulnerability is Peter stepping into the water. And I think that's one of the things we need to look at. Why people who walk with God were vulnerable in their response to God. They were never rigid on their response to God. They were never rigid on their knowledge of God. They were never rigid on their walk with God. I want you to know something very important. Because God is the source of your current knowledge, you should trust Him in a vulnerable manner to say, if I get to know or I got to know what I know from Him, I should trust Him to know that He knows more and He has better plans. Vulnerability comes from the understanding of total trust in God, in a sense that He knows where He's taking me to. He has better thoughts and better plans, and therefore I will not succumb to my reasoning. The Bible says, and I look at it from the scriptures. If you don't mind, let's refer together to the scriptures in the book of Proverbs chapter 3 verses 5. A very simple scripture. It's a language of vulnerability. I said vulnerability is when you take your relationship with God from your head to your heart. When you trust God without a thought, without question, without doubt, it is exactly what Abraham did. Left home, going nowhere. Left what was obvious, going to the unknown. Left wealth, going to a strange land. He followed nothing. Now listen, our response and vulnerability to God, if reason as a human being, it sounds like foolishness. No wonder the Bible describes our response to God is equated to foolishness. It is foolish to human beings. It doesn't make sense for Abraham to leave home where he was born, where his family grew, where his father established his heritage, and go to another direction. He was not given direction. He was not given destination. He was not given distance. He was not given anything. He left without knowing direction. The Bible says he did not know where he was going to. Isn't that foolishness? It is a state of vulnerability where, in a sense, it looks like disobedience to something. It's like you are walking into the unknown at the expense of what is known. And that's why we call it the walk of faith. What is faith? Walking into the unknown based on the trust you have in God. And therefore, Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 says, lean on, trust in, and be confident in the Lord with all your heart and mind. And do not rely on your own insight or understanding. Let me repeat it again. Lean on, trust in, and be confident in the Lord with all your heart and mind. And listen to the opposite of that. Do not. So if you say you are trusting God, you are leaning on Him, you have confidence in Him, you are simply saying the opposite of this statement. That you are not relying on your own insight, that is knowledge, that is your own knowing or understanding or reasoning. That is vulnerability. It means you don't count on your own insight, your own understanding, the way things are run, the way the norms of life. There is a confidence you have in God that makes you vulnerable into His hands. The Bible says, trust God from the bottom of your heart. That's what the Message Bible says. Trust God from the bottom of your heart. Don't try to figure out everything on your own. That is being vulnerable. If you look at the same scripture in Proverbs, in Message Bible, it says, trust God from the bottom of your heart. Do not even try to figure out everything. Isn't that foolish? Isn't that being vulnerable? But that is what makes faith meaningful. That's what makes God relevant. That is exactly what our expression of trust in God means. That's what makes God happy. That's what makes God feel like you believe in Him and you lean not on your own understanding. Listen, friends, you must be flexible to the leading of God to the point you make a fool of yourself sometimes. This is a lesson I've learned in life in my little walk with God. You must be so flexible to the leadings of God. To an extent, it sounds you become a fool to yourself. If you are to explain to your friends, your brothers, your mama, or your daddy, or anybody on exactly what you're talking about, it doesn't make sense. It is called being vulnerable to God. It is actually leaning on God, stepping on water. Peter, what will you tell your wife when you go home wet? You try to walk on water. How? Somebody called Jesus told me to walk out of the ship. Now listen, out of the boat. Remember, Peter, look at the wisdom of God. Peter was a technocrat in the sea. He had lived and walked and served in the sea. That was his threat. That was his profession. That was his area of service. I suppose his father could have been a fisherman. So he inherited fishing as a profession. Now, Peter knows the danger of stepping in water. He knows you will sink. I suppose Peter must have known or seen or was a witness of some of his friends who sank, who died, who were destroyed by the storms. I am sure in the process of his profession, there are people who must have died. There are people who must have died out of storms. There are people who must have died in the sea while they were pursuing their dreams. Now, Peter knows that storms and water can kill you. And they kill you against your wish. But now you are stepping into the same water out of your own will, out of your own volition. Because somebody somewhere said, whom you suspect could be Jesus, step into the water. You have to be so vulnerable and flexible to a level you even seem to be making a fool of yourself. Listen to this scripture in the book of Job. Job chapter 33, verses 14. The power of being vulnerable. Understanding the power of being vulnerable. Job says in verses 14 of chapter 33, he says something like this. He says, For God does reveal his will. For God does reveal his will. He speaks not only once, but more than once, even though men do not regard or including you. It says in the King James, he says, for God spoke once, yet twice I've heard, yet man perceived him not. Now listen, that God speaks once, twice, but man would even not perceive him. But another man of God says, the Lord has spoken once, I heard him twice. You know what that means? I'm vulnerable. What do I mean by being vulnerable? I allow the wind of God to lead. I allow the grace of God to lead. I allow the mind of God to lead. Listen, this man is saying in simple words, I get to a point where even if it means making a fool of myself, I will be vulnerable. I would rather be ridiculed. I would rather be thought as a fool. I would rather be called an unreasoning human being or a thoughtless man or a man who has lost his mind. But if that means the cost of obeying God, I don't mind being vulnerable. I look at Peter and I realize, Peter, no wonder Jesus left the church with Peter. Peter was so vulnerable to Christ, among the first called disciples. How do you explain? A stranger walked by the seashore. You have a profession that you've built for life. You have a family, you have children. You have a name, you have a family lineage. This is something you are known. It's a company. You remember Jesus had associates. He had built associates of his business. He had his fellow fishermen. That's why the Bible talks at some point that he called his colleagues. How do you, with your normal reasoning mind, obey a call from a stranger standing at the seashore without asking him, who are you? Where are you from? Why should I follow you? What about my wife? What about my children? What about my profession? What about my colleagues? What about the family name? Jesus said to Peter, follow me. And the wise, mature man, older than Jesus, the fame of Jesus had not been heard. Jesus had not healed anybody. Jesus had not performed any miracle. Peter should have known better that this is a stranger, a young man trying to make a living. But listen, from the word go, Peter left his ship and followed Christ without thinking about the repercussion. No wonder Jesus said, you are no longer Simon. You are no longer a reed. You are a stability. Now let me tell you something. Contrary to our human reasoning, vulnerability is more of a stability than reasoning. Let me say that again. Vulnerability is more a stability than our human reasoning. Look at it from the perspective of Peter. Initially, Peter seemed to be vulnerable. The Bible calls him Simon, a reed, unstable. He's like the waves. He looked from the human perspective like he was a good businessman. He was a good entrepreneur. But from the description of his name, he was unstable. He was actually vulnerable to life. In other words, listen, this is powerful. In other words, the motivation of Peter's pursuit was not vision, confidence, and faith in God. It was the fear of the unknown. Come with me. Listen. If you are pursued in life, your commitment to life, your pursuit for success is driven by fear, driven by need, you are a reed. You are a Simon. What do I mean by that? When COVID comes around, when Corona comes around, when the economy collapses, when government changes, the Simon, the reed, the unstable, but humanly looking competent, but motivated by fear and the uncertainty of life, you will collapse. On the contrary, Peter looks vulnerable to the human mind, but in God, he is no longer Simon, he's Peter. Look at the mystery here. From the human perspective, he looks like a hardworking man, a good father, an entrepreneur, a passionate man, a dreamer, a man who wants to build a legacy. He works overnight. He spends the whole night looking for fish. He's a responsible man. That is a human point of view. But on God's point of view, he was saying, you are leaning on your own understanding. You are working on your own sweat. You are trying to impress people. You are actually motivated by need. Look at me, friends. The power behind your motivation determines the stability of your achievements. Let me say it again. The power behind your motivation determines the stability of your achievements. In other words, if you are pursued, your motivation is fear, lack, the unfortunate, the future, the unknown. If you are working hard and your motivation is anything other than confidence in God, you are on a shaky ground. You seem committed, you seem zealous, but in the issues of life, you are actually vulnerable. What do I mean? When a challenge like this comes, everything collapses. Everything goes down. It's like your life has come to an end. But look at Simon. When he moved into a vulnerability, which we call depending on God and not in his own understanding. It means counting on God, leaning on God, like the Bible says in Proverbs, trusting in the Lord with all his heart. You know what happened? He refused to lean not. He refused to trust. He refused to put confidence. He refused to put his trust in his own understanding, his own insight, his own knowledge, his own wisdom, and lean on God. Peter is such a vulnerable man that when you tell him, walk on water, he will walk on water. Peter is such a vulnerable man that when you tell him, leave your boat, he will leave the boat. Peter is such a vulnerable man that when you tell him, go to the sea, the first fish you will catch has money, he will go. Peter is such a vulnerable man that he will take a sword and defend his master against a team of soldiers. Peter is such a vulnerable man that he will say to Jesus, let everybody else turn away from you. I will stick with you. Peter is such a vulnerable man that Jesus said, because of the trust and confidence, walked away from everything that you counted on, the things you leaned on, the things that everybody leaned on, and have trusted and lean on me and have confidence in me. I have built my church on that understanding. Now listen, vulnerability comes from the revelation you have about God, about his faithfulness. I look at somebody else like Moses. Before God can use you, you must be vulnerable to his leading. Because you know what, ladies and gentlemen? God does not drive people. God does not contend with people. What made the children of Israel miss Canaan? they became rigid, they became stubborn. Actually, the Bible, God calls them as stiff-necked. Stiff-necked means people whose necks are stubbornly focused on something. People who stubbornly believe in something that they can't bend. They can't bend. God describes them as stubborn-necked people. And you know what that means? Because they did not become vulnerable to the leading of God. They lean on their own understanding. They ask questions like this. And I pray you've never asked questions like this, especially in moments like this. People who are stiff-necked, people who don't succumb to the leading of God, always ask questions like what they ask. Did you bring us to the wilderness to die? Were there graves in Egypt? You brought us to kill us here. We would have lived in Egypt and served as slaves because there was food. They thought about pumpkins, that which was obvious. Onions, that which we are guaranteed of at the expense of trusting God. And God says, you know what? If you can't be flexible, I can't force you. I can't drive you. That's why God described, if you look at scriptures, there are people who are described by God as wild donkeys. Some people are described as horses. Some people are described as oxen. Some people are described in various names. They are describing their vulnerability to God. But look at Moses. Moses is this wonderful man who chooses vulnerability in obedience to God other than being rigid to the way things are. Moses is so vulnerable that he did not, if you look at the Bible in the book of Hebrews, the Bible says he considered living and suffering with his brothers in the wild, out there in the bush, better than staying at the palace and enjoying the beauty and the sweetness of the palace. Moses is so vulnerable that when God approached him in the burning bush, listen to how vulnerable the man is. He went to see what was burning in the bush. When he got there, a voice said, "Remove your shoes." The boy was so vulnerable that he did not ask questions. He removed his shoes. "Drop the rod you have." He was so vulnerable, he dropped the rod. Moses was so flexible to God. Listen, friends, being led by God is through your flexibility to his promptings, to his leading, and not being rigid to how things work or how things work then. I said yesterday, you must always settle in your heart to this understanding. God has never or doesn't or will ever do the same thing in us. Do something in the same way as much as he might do the same thing over and over, but he will never or has never done it the same way. You can't reduce God to a formula. You can't reduce God to a pattern. You can't reduce God to a miracle. Look at Jesus. All the miracles he did all of them differently. In another occasion, he will touch the blind man and say, "Be healed." To another occasion, he will just tell him, "Be healed." In another occasion, he made clay mud and put it on the socket of his eyes. In other words, he can heal the sick. But you don't limit him to a pattern, a formula. Because that is where religion comes, and that's where idolatry comes, and that is reducing God to one formula. You know what that means? God has a million and one ways of blessing you. Be vulnerable. When he says turn left, don't be stiff-necked. Don't be too committed to what God was than what God is. You should not act like you know better than him. Learn to be vulnerable to him. And somebody's asking a question. How do I know it is God? How do I know it is God? It's simple. Being vulnerable makes you know that it is God. Listen, friends. The Spirit of God does not force. He leads. He is gentle. He will only prompt you. He will remind you. He will quicken you. But he will not force you. You must be willing to die to your own fears. That's vulnerability. You must be willing to die to your own fears. You must be willing to die to your doubt. You must be willing to die to your pain. You must be willing to die to your revenge. You know what that simply means? I have nothing to lose. And I like what Paul says. He said, I've considered everything rubbish in consideration to the excellence of my obedience to him. Vulnerability. Vulnerability simply means you die to your own fears. You die to shame. You die to people's thoughts. You die to people's perception. You die to the uncertainty. You die to what the future has. You know what that simply means? Paul says, what shall separate me from the love of God? He says, I am dead to all those things. I count everything as rubbish. If God says today, turn left, you should. You should be so vulnerable that if God told you when there is a meal on your table, don't eat, you should be willing to die to your consciousness and let the will of God prevail. If God told you, hand over the key of your car to your friend, you should be so vulnerable, trusting that he knows what he's doing. You should be so vulnerable that you trust God like Abraham. Take your only son, and God confirmed, take your only son and go to a 3 days journey and kill him, and you carry him with wood and with a knife without knowing how God will provide. Actually, Abraham, the Bible says, on principle, is considered that Isaac died. Abraham was vulnerable. But listen to the response of God, and we'll look at that in the future. Look at the response of God. Abraham, now I know that you love me. Now I know that you honor me. Vulnerability is an expression of our trust and love to God. I want you to mark that as we come to a close. Vulnerability is an expression of our love, or our trust and love to God. You are vulnerable to a man you trust. You are vulnerable to a man you love. You are vulnerable to a person you trust. You know what that simply means? You can close your eyes. Look at the child, our own children. I have a small girl. She will come to my hands and sleep. She doesn't care where she will spend the night. As long as I slept in daddy's hands, I am sure my vulnerability is an expression of trust and love for my father. In a season like this, trust in the Lord and lean not in your own understanding. When the Lord speaks once, you should be vulnerable to hear what he didn't say. I bless you. There's this song that says, Lord, I give you my heart. I give you my soul. Lord, I live for you alone. Every breath that I take and every moment when I'm awake. Lord, have your way in me. I say it again. Lord, I give you all my heart, and I give you my soul, and I decree that I will live for you alone, and every breath that I take and every moment, Lord, when I am awake. Oh Lord, I surrender to you. Have your way. Have your way. Let's say it together. Lord, I give you my, and I give you my soul. I'll be vulnerable, Lord. I'll live for you alone. For you alone. Every breath that I take and every moment when I'm awake. I surrender to you, Lord. Have your way in me. Have your way in me. And I speak a wonderful, blessed afternoon. And your week is secured in grace. Walk in that vulnerability. Close your eyes, because you trust him. Lift your hands, because you trust him to fight your battle. Walk into the unknown, because you expect him to order your steps. Your afternoon and your future is secure in God. In Jesus' name, amen. Blessings and grace to you from the Now family. We'll see you tomorrow, same time, same place. If you want to worship the Lord with your giving today, our PayPal number is projected right on your screen. Just worship the Lord. Let him know that you love him. And I trust something good is happening. Love you. Shalom, Pastor Mike Zay. I can't serve God because my husband does not approve. That's exactly what the devil wanted. I can't serve God because we can't agree with my wife. That's exactly what the devil wanted.
There shall be showers of blessing, precious rain.